You're in curse.
We've had a good show so far.
Yes.
It's all shit to me, though, from before this. We had Michael Chiklis came in, Ricky Gervais, Craig calling. We love Ricky.
Yeah.
And Dane's calling in a little while. Fantastic. But Micheal Williams.
Yes. Micheal Williams joining us from The Wire.
I cannot be fucking happier.
Man, thank you. Thank you for calling me down.
Omar.
I cannot be. I've never wanted to get a guest in. Maybe Ozzy Osbourne is the only comparable guest to me to get in. You are a hard guy to get in studio. It was just a lot of stuff that was going wrong, and we were trying for a long time.
Apparently, he was a busy guy, too.
Yeah, you know? Trying to pay them bills.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, he's in the new Spike Lee movie.
Yeah. Come Miracle on. At St. Anna's, which I saw. And there's another movie you're doing, too, right?
I got The Road coming out, the new Cormac McCarthy book. That'll be out on my birthday, actually, in November. And then I got Brooklyn's Finest with that Fuqua directed. And I got to be opposite two of my mentors, Don Cheadle and Wesley Snipes.
Don Cheadle's great.
Phenomenal.
Yeah.
I just saw his movie, Traitor. The other
man.
Day. When you called me to go see that movie, I was in Traitor. Traitor's
the, there's a guy that climbed from, like, just kind of a peripheral player to a fucking star, you know? The guy Hotel Rwanda was like, wow.
Man, I've been following Don since Devil in Blue Dress.
Really?
Yeah, he kind of popped on my radar. Since then.
His performance in Boogie Nights was great.
Amazing.
I mean, that whole movie was great. The whole movie was fantastic.
Yeah, favorite,
and he didn't have a huge part in it, but it was just like, when he's at that bank, just going, please,
bank,
can you, please, I just need that. You're like, oh, God damn.
You're not being fair.
Yeah.
Like, that's such a childlike thing to say to an adult. That's such a basic reaction. You're not being fair.
You're not being fair. This is not fair.
This is like, not fair. I could do this. I want to open my
stereo store.
Him and his big dick and his fucking porn career.
You know what I mean?
And his cowboy outfit.
When the murder happened in the diner, the sheer look of fear his face with his hands up, like, and the blood
splatter. You saw that cash laying there?
What?
And his awful fake dreads that he had, that fucking dread wig at the party. My favorite moment is just sitting there with those shitty dreads trying to look intense.
I believe that was on the New Year's Eve party, right?
Yes.
The dreads, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
It's just fantastic. And then you see him in, like, Hotel Rwanda and stuff. It's just fantastic, you know, yeah, really.
I bugged out on him on the first day at rehearsal because I went on this whole tangent about Talk to Me and the Petey Green story, and I was doing all the, I'm Petey Green.
Oh, the radio.
The radio guy.
I haven't seen that. I heard it was great.
Oh, God, you got to see it. It's off the fucking hook. But so I like kind of embarrassed myself for that.
That's good. Like, when I walked in, I'm a fanboy, too. Like, when I see somebody I like, I see him talking to Master Poe. And I'm like, is Master Poe fucking hassling him coming in?
Nah, you got to respect the senseis, you know what I mean?
Big Master Poe.
Back in Jersey.
Are you a martial artist?
I'm not a martial artist. I'm getting my butt kicked in the dojo right now. That's why I'm
working on it.
I'm working on my Wesley Snipes. I ain't nowhere near there, but yeah, I trained up there in Union.
How long have you been taking it?
About 3 months now.
Oh, you just started. Okay.
I'm sore as shit.
Oh, so yeah, you're at that phase.
What are you taking?
Karate, and it is the see, I tell you, I'm really doing this. It's karate mixed with boxing.
Opaque belt?
No, I am no belt right
no
now.
No belt? They don't give you a belt?
Bro, I'm still trying to stretch to get my leg up.
Really?
Yeah.
I took karate once, and then I split my gi because I was too fat, so I quit.
Nah, man.
Good for karate.
You know how hard it is to split a gi?
I don't think it's ever been done before.
Never.
Oh, hey, you're in the Guinness World Book now.
Twice.
Now, we come in here, you're a nice soft-spoken guy and everything, but now on The Wire, how did you get that where did that badass come from?
Oh, that ain't me. That ain't me. See, we have a rule on The Wire. If your phone goes off, it's $25. If it goes off while we're filming, that's $50.
All right.
You got to get them. You got to get them.
That's a pretty good one. Opie would owe a lot of money.
Yeah.
We all would. We bought a playground in Baltimore with the money we made from that. We built a little basketball court for the kids in the hood. But I just pretty much, I knew the character came written the way it was. There was nothing much for me to add. So I knew I wanted to just make him sound like a Baltimorean. I didn't want him to sound like a kid from Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
I knew I didn't want him to look like a kid from New York dressing like that. I immediately saw that Baltimore got their own swagger. So I would spend hours in the street and just listen and watch the comings and the goings. I got to watch, girl go in the morning and boy come out. For your, those who don't know, that's crack and dope. You know, crack goes in the morning, dope comes out.
I swear to God, I thought it was some kind of a tranny reference.
Of course you did.
I swear to God.
You were hoping.
Boy or girl is coke and dope. Okay.
Really?
I would watch the streets. I would watch the streets. I would listen. I would sit in the Lexington Market for hours and just listen to dialects and people's tones. And, you know, with the help of David and Ed and the directors they brought out, just kind of came together. And I went to the shooting gallery, which is the roof of my old projects in Brooklyn. And
really?
You know, yeah, I had to learn how to, because you know, I didn't want to do the whole, the Hollywood thing with the gun.
Yeah.
I never really shot a gun before Omar. So, I want to know what would it look like for a guy my frame to hold a big ass gun. So I went to the shooting gallery in my hood on my with my building. I had to learn how to bust a gun for a little bit. You know what I mean? But
yeah, those are fun.
Yeah,
believe me, I'm an avid collector.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
So you must have loved the scene in season 3 when Omar and Brother Muzon had that little gun conversation.
I'm not up to season 3. Yeah,
no.
I know. I was one of the last. I'm the last one to get into the wire. But like, you know, in this day and age, I like doing the 48-hour film festival where you sit there and just keep putting DVDs
That's
in.
That's the way to do it.
Though. Oh man,
no
commercials, no
commercials,
nothing. You're sitting there, your eyes are red, drinking a beer. What?
To-go containers everywhere.
Yeah. One more, and then you're like. Just one more episode, man. One. It's like, I'm definitely going to sleep after this one. And then they end it in a way where it's like, well, fuck, now I gotta watch at least the beginning of it, and then before you know it, it's over.
You start out watching it, you're fully clothed, but then you just have one sock half on.
Please.
Tipping off the tips of your toes.
I tell people, like, who just now, when I meet people in the street, they're like, yo, I just bought the whole 5 seasons and we're gonna watch it. I'm like, okay, you have to get some survival tactics. You need water, you need food, you need something by the couch because your bucket to relieve yourself.
Yeah, you'll just
you are
sit
not
there.
Moving.
Yeah.
So just understand that.
Donuts, water, and something to sit on and shit at the same time. That scene, by the way, in season 3 with Brother Muzon is a great scene because you shot him in a great moment where you call 911 for him after you shot him. It's just, and they're discussing their weapons. Just these two guys who are probably going to shoot each other. Discussing Jesus. Their weapons. So
you
great,
would love
man.
That.
Fantastic.
You
love
it. It's such a... Everyone I've turned on to the show fucking goes out of their mind for the show. They're like, why was this not higher publicized? Because the critics loved it, but never nominated. I've mentioned that many times, which is sickening. House and all these fucking dumb shows that are nominated. House. Oh, the doctor does
once
it again
he's got to find out why a child is bleeding from the ass on an all new House.
All right, we get it. He handles weird cases. So you were saying you grew up in Brooklyn?
Yeah, Flatbush.
So now,
Bondivere.
All right. I lived in Brooklyn for a while. I kind of steered clear of Flatbush. But
smart man.
Now did you get out of there? Obviously, you know, you're an actor. You're doing very well. It seems like you would have gotten out of there kind of young. Or
I just can't seem to get out the hood for some
reason. No?
I don't even know if I really want to get out the hood. I kind of like the hood. I'm in Newark right now where they got bodies dropping all around.
Yeah, the garden spot of the Garden State.
Yeah, man. I got the 4 young girls got murdered around the corner from me. So
I was just watching a show called Jack last night, which is on...
Jack, yeah.
Yeah, and it's the squad that goes around Jersey, and they were in Newark during the episodes I was watching. Mm-hmm. And they just put in plate numbers of cars, and just by luck... They find stolen cars all the time. People driving around, and that's all they do all night.
Shout
Newark
out to
seems
Newark.
To be
up the hook right now.
Yeah. It's like they're just stealing cars like crazy over there.
Cars, lives.
Yeah,
money,
it's just insane. Now, what's the attraction to being in that atmosphere when you know you're obviously doing very well?
I like you. I like you. We gonna hang out, but I mean, you know what I'm saying? It's affordable for number one, and my family's there. You know, I still go back to my hood in Brooklyn. I still have family out there, and you know, we chill. I go visit my aunts and, you know, my godkids.
Yeah?
Yeah, my godkids. He said, yeah.
Yeah. No. You got friends over there, though, that are kind of still in the life or anything? Or
What kind of, yeah, like, you mean alive?
Yeah, no,
the
still,
life, like the
yeah,
old,
yeah, like, kind of
oh, hell yeah.
Fucking
I mean,
around a little bit too much. And
yeah, you know, we've all been there, but, yeah. I got friends, I got people that know Mike. Yeah. Before the Omar thing.
Yeah, yeah. That's kind of, I can understand that a little bit. People kind of take, because people kind of take us for what we're worth here on the show. And it's a little odd when you meet people and it's like, no, I don't act like that all the time. I'm not like that all the time.
I'm not drunk off my face all the time.
Well, no, that I am. But yeah. No.
You mean sober. I don't act like that all the time.
Yeah, there you go.
It's so hard. Like I know as an artist, you want to move on and you want to do like all these other projects and you want to be, but it's like I just want to fucking. I'm like a 5-year old. I just want to fucking say Omar things. All I want to do is say "What up, bird." That's all I want to say. Probably one of the best. For anyone that hasn't seen it, he's falsely testifying against the guy to get him thrown away for a murder because the guy is a piece of shit. I mean, Bird's a piece of shit, but he wants Bird and he and Bird both know he's lying through his teeth, and they say, "Do you see the defendant in court?" And he looks at the guy who he's lying about. He goes, "Yo, what up, Bird?" And he just wants to fucking cut your throat. It's such a great moment. What up, Bird?
That was one of my favorites, by the way. The court scene was definitely one of my favorite scenes. That's in season 2. But like in the beginning, I remember people started coming to me like, "Yo, Omar,
is that season 2 or season 1?
That's season 2. The courtroom scene was season 2.
With Bird?
Yeah, with Bird. When we're in the courtroom and he's testifying.
I think that's season 1.
Look at you arguing with the guy that was in it.
He's in it.
Shut up, Jimmy.
I love this
fanboy. No, no, he's in it, but I've watched it more.
I believe him, too.
He doesn't watch it and go, "Omar." He just goes, "Oh, it's me again. Let me fast forward." But, you know, wasn't that, was for the, oh, you know what, he probably is right. That was for the civilian murder.
Yeah, when the working man got worded right. The courtroom scene didn't happen until season 2.
Oh.
Yeah.
All right, I'll stand corrected. Since the guy who did it, I really should have my fucking teeth kicked
in. Don't feel bad. I made so much money last year on people betting whether that was Michael that killed Bodie.
Oh, really?
I made so much money off of that side betting.
You know, you could win a lot of money off of people asking what season of Lucky Louie it was.
I love.
It got a laugh from the people.
Oh, you know Lucky Louie?
I got starstruck again. He came to the premiere of
Jesus. Not you, him. Lucky Louie.
I love Lucky Louie, bro.
Yeah, I know him as Louie.
I didn't miss an episode.
Did you recognize me when I came in from Lucky Louie?
You.
Oh my God! Oh shit! Holy shit! I'm laughing, but this is pissing me off to no end.
You the neighbor, the crazy fucking neighbor. Yeah, I love you. You and the fucking
Does this piss me off?
Walk around naked all the time.
Oh yeah, Rick Shapiro.
God, fuck,
someone check.
You got me cursing, man. Damn.
Dude, no, that you don't know how much this pisses me off. Because I hate when he really likes an actor and they come in and know the motherfucker.
I love Lucky Louie. Dude, I watch that shit every time.
I made the joke to goof on him, and it backfired.
I'm thinner now than I was then. That's probably why he didn't recognize me. A man walks in and shape.
Nah,
it's kind of hard
face,
to see.
That face. You know,
it's a shape, all right.
Ask Sensei. When you was coming down the hallway, I said, "I know that face."
Yes,
I swear to my God, I was telling Sensei that.
Damn.
Oh, in the hallway.
Yep.
Damn it.
That makes me very happy.
I'm sure it does. It makes me miserable.
It made me mad. It took it off the air.
No, I'm not going to cry. But another guy from The Wire who was actually a fan of Lucky Louie was fucking Method Man.
I think me and Meth had some conversations about Lucky Louie.
Yeah.
We talked about that. We talked about your show on the set. We had lines from your show we bring it on, and we laughed. There was something, you know, I smoked a lot of side pot. So it was a fry. But you had a few one-liners on that show that we started running them. Man, I had skits from Lucky Louie. I said, "Did you see what that was happening?" He was like this, this, and that.
Oh, that makes me so fucking happy.
How'd you like his acting? Was his acting good?
Man, that whole show was incredible, man. That was real life comedy. Like
very Honeymooners-ish.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, definitely.
Like, you know, the X-rated version of Honeymooners.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, the R-rated.
And Louie never sweetened any of the laughs, because every comedy sweetens them. They all balance the laughs, and they put in these little laugh tracks to even it out. Yeah. And he never won. People would complain, some of the critics, that the laughs are too loud because these little fucking pussies, they're used to these sitcom laughs to get evened out. Louie didn't do that.
No, you had real people in there laughing.
Yeah.
That's what you needed. That's what you needed in The Wire, a little laugh track. Imagine that horrible, some horrible shit going down and just, that awful.